In coursework and things and subjects like human physiology, we're really very rarely interested in atoms or in atomic structure for their own sake. What we're really interested in more is how particles interact with each other. How do atoms interact with other atoms? And in this sense, we're very interested in the valence shell of atoms because, as I noted in the last lecture, this outermost shell occupied by electrons is the portion of an atom that will interact with another atom. And the electrons within the valence shell are what we call valence electrons. Those are the electrons occupying that shell. As a very quick aside to any chemists who might be watching this, I realize there are some problems with this particular definition, but the places where those problems come up the most, like the transition metals, aren't relevant to coursework in human physiology, really, at least not to introductory coursework. So we're going to go with this definition as a simplifying matter. So if we look at several examples and identify how many valence electrons they have, we can start with the simplest atom, hydrogen, which has one electron in the first shell. So the first shell is the valence shell, and it has one valence electron. Oxygen, which we've looked at previously, has eight total electrons, six of them in the second shell, making the second shell the valence shell, and therefore it has six valence electrons. Chlorine has a total of 17 electrons. Seven of them are in the third valence shell, which is the outer, I'm sorry, the third shell, which is the valence shell as the outermost, so they have seven valence electrons. Atoms with closed valence shells are the most stable and least likely to react with other atoms. This idea of achieving stability is actually really critical here. Atoms that don't have closed valence shells tend to interact with other atoms in ways that lead to closed valence shells and greater stability. So, what determines whether a shell is closed or not? Well, it's all about the number of electrons within the shell. The first shell is closed when it's occupied by two electrons. The second shell is closed when it's occupied by eight, and the third shell is closed when it's occupied by eight. So if we look at an example set of atoms that have closed valence shells, here we have helium, neon, and argon. Helium has two valence electrons in shell number one, so it's closed. Neon has eight valence electrons in shell number two, it's closed. Argon has eight valence electrons in the third shell, making it closed. These three elements come from a portion of the periodic table referred to as the inert gases or the noble gases. There are some other familiar or potentially familiar elements there, like xenon and krypton as well. And all of these gases typically are not found in compounds with other elements. They are having in their atomic form a closed valence shell to begin with, so they're pretty much non-reactive. By contrast, let's go back and look at the three elements we presented before. Hydrogen has one valence electron. Its valence shell needs one more to be closed. Oxygen has six valence electrons. It needs two more to close that shell out. Chlorine has seven valence electrons. It's one electron away from a closed shell. All three of these elements would be, for lack of a better way of saying it, they're looking for a way to close those shells. So the question is, how do atoms achieve closed valence shells? Well, there's a few options. An atom can give up excess valence electrons to another atom to close out its valence shell. An atom can take valence electrons away from another atom to close out its valence shell. Or the third option is two atoms could share their valence electrons with each other so that each has a closed valence shell part of the time. These are the three ways that atoms interact to close their valence shell, and when they interact, the result is what's called chemical bonding. And guess what's next?